Guys, we're at it once again. I don't know about you guys, but you know what? I know, Benny, your phone has been blowing up. You told me the other day that people really enjoyed last week's episode with Carlos Chacon talking about the Hills when he worked the barf team. And I don't know about you guys, but man, I've been really excited about tonight's show. It's going to be outstanding. But before we get started, I know we all have special shout outs. Benny, we'll start off with you. What shout outs do you have?
Well, it's not really a shout out, but just, you know, we lost another deputy sheriff in Riverside County just a few days ago in a car accident. And we lost Deputy Brett Harris, who was assigned to the Hemet Station. He was involved in an on-duty collision. He was on his way to a radio call, suffered major injuries, brain damage, and he passed away. You know, it's just another another loss for Sheriff Bianco in Riverside. On a happier note, you know, this is our episode number 16, which is our fourth month in existence. You know, thank you all for that support and for listening to our podcast. I mean, push that subscribe button. We're not doing bad for 4 months. We are at about 715 subscribers. So thank you all.
Excellent. Benny, hey, may your brother in blue rest in peace. Hey, rest in peace. Big Sean, I know you have a special shout-out, special announcement. Congratulations, my brother.
Yeah, thanks. A shout-out to my daughter, Brooke, and her husband, Jordan. We're just back out in San Diego visiting the kids and the grandkids. And we're going to have another edition. So, you know, hopefully everything goes well. And, you know, we'll have a little muchacho or a little muchacha. So, but real quick. Hey, Chalo. Right there. Yeah. Okay. You did the sweet. that's it.
Sweet. Congratulations, brother.
Stop it.
Yes, chingón de chingones. The former chief of police from Calexico, the one and only Chalo Gerardo. Chalo,
yes, sir. Good, bro. Hey, so check this out, bro. Weather was 102 today. We've been having small earthquakes here, actually a couple of, not even a quarter mile away from my house. The biggest one with a 2.69 this afternoon. We've had 5 so far. So, I mean, you can't really feel them. I just get the alerts. But I just want to send out a shout out to, let me see, man. One of my buddies, he was from Calexico PD, narcotic officer. He ended up leaving Calexico. He worked for Narcotics Task Force for a while here. His name was Hector Rios. I don't know if you guys ever met him, Hector Rios, but he ended up going over to Santa Ana DA's office, retired out of there. He's now living in the great state of Texas. Shout out to him. He's watching this live right now. Great cop, man. One of my mentors, man. I like a father figure, showed me a lot of stuff, a lot of integrity, good, dope cop, worked a lot of undercover stuff, man. And a biggest shout out right now to tomorrow's my wife's 23rd anniversary of her 29th birthday. So I'm going to wish her happy birthday. She just got home. She was working. So she's walking in right now and she gave me that look. So she burned my neck. Anyways, man, you know, other than that, I mean, it's, ya sabes, Imperial Valley, hotter than heck out here. I don't want to say hell because I've never been to hell and I don't want to be in hell.
Hey, right now, when you were wishing her a happy anniversary, you kept looking back. I thought you were looking for the chancla. Getting ready.
No. It's a 23rd anniversary or 29th birthday. So yeah, that's what it is, bro.
We'll add it up from there.
Yeah.
Hey, guys, you know what? Today, it's a special show on the Ayala brothers, and Benny's going to talk all about it. But 3 weeks ago, myself and Benny got the opportunity to go to San Quentin State Prison. And Benny, I had your picture on there for whatever reason. I do not know why it did not come out, but I'll try to put it in while we're talking. But Lieutenant Dean Dino Petrovich. Dean, if you're watching it, Lieutenant Petrovich, I'll tell you, you're one of those guys that when you retire, you need to start your own podcast. You need to start teaching classes. This is a lieutenant that works at St. Quentin, has worked death row, has worked prison gangs, knows the gangs inside and out. took me and Benny to the dungeons of St. Quentin, took us to places that I don't know that a lot of people have gone, took us to death row, and Benny will talk a little bit more. But, brother, thank you very much for watching the show. We love you over here in Florida. It's in San Diego. We respect every one of you. And another big shout-out, not only to you, Lieutenant, but also to the St. Quentin Death Row Correctional Officers and the security squad from St. Quentin. You guys treated Benny and I like gold. Thank you very much. And you know what? We pray that for your safety, and thank you for your outstanding service. And once again, man, mil gracias. Thank you very much. With that said, guys, Benny, it's all yours. I know you have a lot to talk about. Okay, Chalo's showing something up there. What is it, Chalo? Candies?
So my wife gets home from work, and her partner today had these strawberries dipped in, I guess, confectionery chocolate. So they're L.A. baseball, L.A., because we're Dodger fans. It's happy birthday. So is that pretty neat or what, dude?
Oh, that's pretty cool, man. That's all right. Awesome.
Okay, bro.
Well, yeah, they're not going to last the night with you, Chalo.
Oh, hell no. If the screen goes blank, dude, it's because I'm probably going under eating some of these.
Exactly. Hey, Benny, it's all yours, brother. Take it away. Yeah,
sorry, Benny. Go, L.A.
So today we got retired San Diego Police Sergeant Carlos Chacon, who started his career with the San Diego Police Department. Throughout the years, Chacon has established an area of expertise in prison gangs, especially the Mexican Mafia and Nuestra Familia, and in the intelligence field. Carlos is a world of information. On April 26, 1985, Hector and Ronnie Ayala, members of the Mexican Mafia prison gang, tortured and murdered three individuals at a body shop at 43rd Street and National Avenue in Southeast San Diego. A fourth victim managed to escape, but was also shot during the escape. And the victim actually survived. Then Detective Chacon developed sources that would eventually provide information on the killings, the motive, and the location of the two suspects, Hector and Ronnie Ayala. Carlos will tell us the story of this vicious murders and how he developed sources, and how, with the help of LAPD's prison gang unit and the Department of Corrections SSU agents, located the two brothers and made the arrest. It's going to be an incredible show. Welcome to the show, Carlos.
Thank you.
Hey, Carlos, una vez más, bienvenido. You know what? Before we talk about the Ayala murders, I know you were the case agent. You were one of the ones that was responsible for their arrest, for their prosecution, and for providing the home where they're at today. But before we talk about that murder, can you tell us how you heard of them? How long had you heard of them before the homicide? And had you ever had any interaction with Ronnie and Hector Ayala? It's all yours, brother.
Actually, I never really met them. The whole time that you and I were growing up in Otay, that was part of their stomping grounds, even though they were from National City. And the only real time that I used to hear about all their escapades, beating people up, you know, and heartless, brutal brothers and members of the Mexican Mafia. But the first time they came to my attention was Ronnie was, they were trying to control the narcotics distribution in the little town of Otay, community of Otay. And Ronnie went over to one of the guys that was dealing in and wanted him to pay taxes. And he made the mistake of threatening him. He said if he didn't want to pay taxes, he was going to come back and he was going to harm him and his family. Well, Angel Matiote loved his family, still loves his family, if he's still alive, I hope. Ronnie was not as tough as he thought he was. And Angel was more than everybody thought he was. So Angel winds up just beating the crap out of him. I think he even sent him to the hospital. But as a result of that, Ronnie winds up putting a hit on Angel. And Angel was real good friends with the guy that picked up the contract, which was another Mexican Mafia guy by the name of, they called him Rhino, Manuel Mesa. We all grew up together in the same neighborhood. You know, we all ate it, sat at the same tables with our mothers and ate breakfast and lunch or whatever. You know, you go to a Mexican family's house and the mother wants to feed everybody right away. Well, nothing was different back then. So we all grew up together. It just so happens that some of the guys remained neutral, became dope dealers. Others went with the Nuestra Familia. Others went with the Mexican Mafia. And Ronnie was part of the M.A., a Mexican Mafia. And Rhino became a member of the Mexican Mafia as well. But Rhino was every bit as fierce and feared as Ronnie and Hector and anybody else in the area. And when Ronnie went back to prison, he put a hit out on Angel because he beat him up. And the hit went out to Rhino, Manuel Mesa. Well, like I said, we all grew up together and nobody wanted to hit anybody. Not, it's different when you're in the joints and somebody's going with you to make sure you do the hit. If you don't do the hit, they'll hit you. But out on the streets, when there's nobody watching your backs, there's nobody really monitoring you. People just don't want to take care of business out on the streets unless they're really, truly diehard, devoted, you know, stone cold MA or any gang member. But when Ronnie got out of prison, well, first of all, let's go back about the Mexican Mafia a little bit. When they would send somebody a hit, a contract hit, and they didn't carry it out, even in the prison, if you didn't carry it out, they would kill you for not doing what you were told. And then out on the streets, they really didn't have anybody to be on your back the whole time. So what happens is guys would tell me all the time, they would send out these kites or get the kites, you know, you don't have to carry out the contract anymore. You know, we're going to send somebody else to do it. But they would tell them, but you know, you're still in the car. You're still good with us. And then they would send somebody that paroled out to hook up with them. They'd lull them into this false sense of safety. Hey, you're my carnal, you know, I would die for you. I'd walk through fire for you. They tell them everything that they needed to hear. They get really close to them. And then they get loaded with them. And then when they thought they had him in a really weak position, you know, not weak, but where they couldn't handle themselves anymore because they were all doped up or all drunk or whatever, then they'd hit him. They would send their best friends to kill them. Well, Ronnie, when he sent that hit out to Rhino to do Angel, after a while, he kept sending him guys, hey, what's going on? You're not hitting this guy. And Rhino kept coming up with all kinds of excuses. He didn't want to hit his friend. Nobody wants to hit their friends out there. So anyhow, that's just the way it was. But Rhino receives a letter from Ronnie from prison saying, you know what? It's okay. You don't have to do the hit anymore. Have you heard that before? You don't have to do the hit anymore. You're still in the car. You know, you're one of the carnales. You're well-respected. So you don't have to do the hit. We're going to send somebody else to do the hit. Of course, they didn't send anybody else to do the hit. Ronnie gets paroled to the streets. He winds up becoming Rhino's road dog. You know, and they're doing everything together. But Rhino never dropped his guard. He knew how the MA worked. He did it himself. You know, and he had other people do what he knew was coming down the line for him. So he never really dropped his guard. Ronnie gets out. And he hooks up with Rhino on this one day, and they're standing in this on Third Avenue Third and Anita in Otay, and by the 7-Eleven. And here they look up, and there's Angel walking towards them, coming up to the 7-Eleven. Well, Ronnie thinks that he's still tough, and he can still handle Angel. Well, he goes over and he starts fighting with Angel in the parking lot of the 7-Eleven. But just before Ronnie took on Angel, he tells Rhino, I got this. Let me handle it. You just back me up. So next thing you know, Ronnie is on his back getting the crap beat out of him by Angel. And Angel was not a big guy, but he was a really good fighter. And next thing you know, Ronnie is calling out to Rhino, help me, help me, help me, Carnazo. Rhino didn't want to do anything to him, so he takes out a buck knife. You remember this old original folding buck knives? And he goes over and he starts stabbing Angel in the back and in the side, but never really penetrating more than an inch or so, just enough to hurt him, you know, to install some pants. So Angel jumps up, backs up, and runs away. Now, how do I know about these details? Because I got it from the people that were there, the participants. And they're standing there talking about how Ronnie was kicking Angel's ass. Well, they look up, and here's Angel running at them. Now he's got a gun in his hand. So they start running around the back of the 7-Eleven, and it was the back of a church. I think it was Our Lady of Guadalupe. But anyways, as they're jumping, Rhino gets over the fence, and Ronnie starts jumping over the fence. Well, Angel gets off a good shot and shot him in the ass. Ronnie will never say that he got shot in the ass. He got shot in the hip, if you ask him. But anyhow, Rhino winds up still being on the streets. Ronnie winds up being back in prison. Well, he and Hector, his brother, eventually parole back out into the streets, and they still want to kill Rhino. Rhino is not a slouch by any stretch of the imagination. And they know that. And they know that he could hurt one or both of them before they did him in. So what they did is they get hung out with him, lull him into a false, tried to lull him, or so they thought, into a false sense of safety. And they got word that there was a tire shop at 43rd and National in Southeast San Diego. Well, what happened was they heard that money was going to be held there to pay for a big show, dope shipment that was coming in. They recruited Rhino, and Rhino knew this was going to be their opportunity to kill him. You know, at the same time, rip off the money and rip off the dope to boot.
Hey, Carlos, real quick, let me ask you, before we talk about that homicide, talk a little bit about Ronnie and Hector, how they got away with the murder of their brother-in-law, Mauro Gonzalez. Because I have no doubt the homicide. Just a real briefly on that, and then we'll get into the homicide.
Sure.
Not too many people know about that.
They had a horrible reputation for their violence and their propensity for violence, and they didn't mind hurting men, women, or children. And they went over to their brother-in-law, Mauro Gonzalez, he was strung out on dope really bad, but he was married to Ronnie and Hector's sister. And they had twins, and Mauro loved his family, and his wife, the Ayala's sister, loved him a lot too. And I've known both of them for many years, even before I became a cop. But Mauro was going around ripping off the conectas for the M, and Ronnie, Hector, and a third guy went over to Mauro's house, and they want to talk to him. Well, Mauro thought they might try and hurt him or his brother, Mario, who they were been sitting drinking beers on the porch. And Mauro goes into his house, comes back, and comes out with a gun in his waistband. It wasn't a real gun. It was a replica. And Ronnie got a little pissed off when he saw the gun. He goes, "That's for me? You're bringing a gun out here for me?" He goes, "Let me see that gun." And Mauro wouldn't let him near the gun because then he'd know that it was a replica. So he just held on to the guns, you know, and this, what do you got in mind? And then he's like, "No, never mind. Orale, offend me like that. Disrespect me like that. We'll be seeing each other again." So they left. Mauro's anniversary came up with his wife, and he went out to celebrate. He used to score all of his dope real early at Chicano Park, and the Ayalas knew that. And they used a guy named Tony Ferrugia. He was a member of the Logan Red Steps. To lull him, they gave him money and said, according to my sources, they gave him money and they gave him dope. And they had him use all the dope. And Mauro had a horrendous habit. I mean, he had developed an incredible tolerance for all the dope. So the guy kept feeding him dope all day long, and he's not getting weak. So anyways, then they give him money. You know, they had already given money. Tony Ferrugia goes into the store in Chicano Park, liquor store, comes back, and he's still not drunk. He spent all his money, used all his dope, and he still wasn't weak enough for them to try and take him on. So Ronnie and Hector go over to Chicano Park, pick him up, and they, this is according to the sources that I have or had then, they took him to a bar in National City. Según, it was owned by a relative of theirs. And Mauro went to the phone to call his wife to tell him he's going to be a little late because Mauro had had made reservations at a nice restaurant for them for their anniversary. And he told her, look, I'm with your brother, Ronnie and Hector. We're over here at the Elbow Rest, you know, in National City. They're just doing a little bit of celebration for, you know, for our anniversary, and I'll be right there. Well, Mauro never showed up. He disappeared. They found him the next morning in trash bags in the country area, a little country area called Bonita in Chula Vista. Well, when they were taking the body over there, there was somebody that saw them, that knew them on the freeway, and he saw the trash bags flapping in the back. And he winds up eventually telling me that. The sister called me the next day. He's frantic. Remember, we knew each other since we were kids. We were friends, and she didn't suspect her brothers at all. But the word that I got was they were going to, they took him. Oh, she says, he was with my brothers, Ronnie and Hector, and they were at the Elbow Rest. He tells me that, you know, not knowing what had gone on. She never suspected they'd been involved. So as it turns out, when he was found, he had been tortured to death. So I was able to hook him up through the sister, the guy in the truck, and then there were other things that surfaced during the course of the sheriff's investigation. When they grabbed the body and they took the trash bag off the top of the torso. Well, you know, like you and I all, when we throw our trash out, we throw jelly back there, you know, peanut butter, empty jars, and anything that stuck, you know, to the sides. Well, Ronnie did the same thing. They took this thing off and they'd taken all of the trash out and they dumped it out in the alley. Well, they didn't realize that there was a lot of, you know, molasses and stuff or something sticky on the inside. Well, Ronnie had gone to the cleaners the day before and he took the receipt, threw it in the trash, and it stuck to the inside of the trash bag. Now, that's pretty good evidence if you ask me. I could be wrong, and I probably am.
Wow. Okay.
But the sheriffs missed that, you know, and then also too, Mauro's face, it looked like they'd been torturing him. Look at they've been sticking him with an ice pick. And in Mauro's face, it looked like they shot him on the side of the head, side of the face, and his head was up against the floor. It was one of those old, you remember in your elementary schools, they had that hard tile, you know, that it chipped out. You couldn't scrape it off. You had to break it off. Well, when they fired that round, his face was up against that tile. And when the round hit the tile through the face, it exploded the tile back into his face. So there were pieces, fragments of the tile in his face. You know, so they had the tile, they had the receipt, you know, plus I had passed on the information that I had about all the different people that of my sources that the information they'd given me, I passed it on to them. Well, it just so happens that Benny, I'm sorry, but the SO took a long time to get a search warrant for Ronnie's apartment. And I think there were, under the circumstances, there was plenty to go get the search warrant for that. Not to mention that I think they were on parole. But by the time they got the search warrant and been back there, all of the tile in the entire kitchen had been replaced. The place had been painted and cleaned. Any physical evidence that was there was gone.
Hey, Carlos.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. So I'm hearing this. Do you think that maybe the sheriff's office didn't really particularly care about this case since they were all gang related, or they were all, you know, Mexicanos or gang related in a way?
Well, you know, maybe so, but you know, we've all heard them in law enforcement and other, you know, in all fields of law enforcement. Hey, you know, we should just send all the gangs to some stadium somewhere, let them go to each other, you know. That references to that kind of thing. So, yeah, in a way, but I mean, if you get a chance to put somebody as awful as these two human beings are, wouldn't you want to do that?
Yeah.
You know, just go. I mean, out all the way to get them. And that was my thing, you know. I was really upset with the investigators at the sheriff's department. And they did kill their brother. I'm convinced they killed their brother. And I had people telling me all kinds of stories from different places that made sense. You know, it didn't make sense to one person because they weren't there. But when you take all these different stories, you know, and you put them together, you put together a pretty good picture. It's just like when you arrest people, come to San Diego County Jail, members from gangs from all over the state. Those guys only know what's happening in their part of the state. But when they all talk, you know, they paint a really good picture of what's going on. You know more, you wound up becoming more familiar with their activities than each one of those individuals.
But, hey, Carlos, yeah. Carlos, so this murder of Mauro Gonzalez, their brother-in-law, occurs months or not even a year before this big case, the triple homicide.
Yes, so I believe now, so.
Okay, so now let's get into this triple homicide. Let's get in it. It happened on April 25th, 1985. Location, New Life Auto Body Shop, located at 43rd and National. The victims, Ernesto Chacho Dominguez, which was the owner of the body shop, Marco Zamora, and Jose Rositas. When did you first hear about this case, Carlos? Tell us about when you first heard about it.
I get a call from a source that had been in there, in the actual body shop, when Ronnie, Hector, and Kukui, that was the name of the killer driver, Moreno, they all arrived there, and they're just not leaving, you know, they're and Chacho, the owner, Chacho, right?
Chacho, yes,
Chacho, the owner, goes over to my source and says, "You know what? You know, this is I don't have a good feeling here. Why don't you go wait across the street, you know, at the park, and I'll call you when it's safe for you to come back." Well, while my source is over there, she sees a Hector come out of the body shop and go over to this abandoned vehicle that's on the side of the building. And he's tossing it. He's going, and he comes back inside. And what the source sees a few minutes later, the it had one of those old garage doors, the kind that flips up, you know, as opposed to roll up. And she sees a guy come through the crack, and the door comes back down. And then he starts running out towards the street. At 43rd and National, it was a T intersection. And Hector comes out and shoots at the guy. And shoots him in the ass. The guy falls into the middle of the street. And almost immediately after that, they hear sounds, three sounds, bang, bang, bang. I mean, almost that quick. And that's Ronnie executing the three guys inside the auto shop. Then all three of them come out and get in Kukui's van. Now, you'd think that these guys would have been smart enough. They were cocky enough to take the most gaudish van. You know, you've seen these vans with Vikings and the big bolts and the hammers and the dragons and all that. Well, that's essentially the kind of things that were painted on this van. You couldn't miss it. It is sent out from a mile away. Hold on a second.
It was like the Partridge Family van, like that.
Oh, the Partridge Family van was a covert surveillance vehicle, as far as we're concerned.
Hey, but, David, did you own one of those vans in the past?
No, never at all. Carlos did.
No,
the brown van. Carlos,
David was more of the Partridge van kind of guy.
Orale.
But what happened was they get out, they take off, and they actually the unit that found them. David has talked about him before. McElroy.
Yes, Tony McElroy.
Tony McElroy and his partner are making the turn onto the. They're one block away, short block from where the guy is laying in the middle of the intersection, you know, with a bullet in his ass. Yeah. I'm sorry.
No, oh, go ahead.
Anyhow. They pull up and they're thinking, because it was a dope fiend drunk, you know, a wino hangout. And they're thinking, oh God, another drunk. So they get out and this guy, he's got his hands tied behind him or tape behind him with basket duct tape. And he's first thing he says, go check out my friends. They're in the tire shop. And so one guy goes over there, and I think McElroy stayed with him. But then they put out, got three homicides here, you know, and then, of course, everything goes out. Well, by now, my source that had been out at the park was already calling me on the phone with me. And she's telling me what she saw. So I immediately called homicide, passed that information on to them. And then the second good reliable source was the guy that had been shot in the ass. He knew who they were, too. And he kind of picked up the story where my source left off when the source left the body shop. So we had two good sources right off the bat. And then...
Carlos, Sean has a question for you. Here we go, Sean. Go ahead, Sean.
Hey, Carlos, tell us about the investigative process that you started initially when you got there.
Well, actually...
At the beginning of this investigation.
I kind of stayed away from there. I didn't go into it. It was a crime scene, so I didn't go in. But everybody was there right away. Homicide still hadn't gone home, so there, you know, it was still early enough where they hadn't gone home. So they responded right away, and then I hook up with the homicide team, and I work with them, give them all my information, which turned out to be right on. And then sources were calling me from everywhere, telling me what they'd heard on the streets about who had done it, who was there, who was the driver. And they disappeared right off the bat. But Kukui disappeared, and I kept hearing that he was in Arizona with family. Well, months afterwards, Kukui, you know, like almost all criminals who put on witness protection or leave the scene of the crime, they get lonely. They want to come back and spend time. They want to hook up with their family again. Well, Kukui had a wife and kids out here, and they had a house over on, I think it was 30th Street. And he winds up coming over here. So I would follow his wife. Every day she'd leave, I'd follow her. And there was this, thank God, there was this elementary school on an elevated position overlooking his sister's house. And his wife would go over to the sister's house on this puro sapo, in English, just out of sheer out of luck. I'm looking down at him after they got there, and I see her come out, and she's looking around, and then she motions for him to come to the van. And this guy runs out, gets in the side, and he jumps in the back. Well, I know it's him. I mean, my heart, I mean, I am. It's really hard for me to keep a calm voice when I'm putting it out on the air, you know? So I get behind him, and this guy, they had louvered windows, I believe it was. And I could see him. I could see these eyes looking out these louvered windows. He'd pick them up. And I go, oh, I got you now, buddy. So anyways, I put it out. We go over there. And sure enough, she pulls into a gas station. By now, we got all kinds of cars. When you put out, you know, I'm behind a possible suspect, homicide, you know, and if you put out the vehicle location, everybody wants to have a piece of that. So everybody gets into the parking lot of the whole station, the gas station. She comes out, and I'm right now by the pay window. She comes out. I grab her arm, pull her off to the side, and I say, is Kukui in the van? And she kind of just like broke down, and she says, yes. So the rest is, you know, we did a hot stop. He came out, took him into custody. And I'll tell you something about the investigation. It was very disheartening for me. But we wound up with regards to Ronnie and Hector. We would hold prison gang task force meetings throughout the state. So anyhow, is Brian still alive by any chance?
Yes, he is. As a matter of fact, we were with him 3 weeks ago, and he sends his respect, Carlos.
Likewise, Brian. Likewise. So anyhow,
this is what he looked like right here when he arrested them, and this is what he looks like now. He just wrote a really good book on the Nuestra Familia. Great man, legend in law enforcement.
I'll have to look that up.
Hey, Carlos, real quick, so let's go back. I mean, some people that I'm watching that they're joining on or they've been on. So you were assigned to what during that time?
Intelligence.
Okay, yeah, because you said that the homicide detectives got there and stuff like that, and then of course you said that your sources were calling you with all kinds of information. So you were assigned to the intel unit at that time. That's why that was chingona back then, because you got all the info. off the
street. What made me really good is I never had to do hardly any paperwork at all. I would just get the information, get the sources, and give them to the right people. Hey. You know, and maybe on a little 3x5 card, I'd write something, but to my sergeant. But with regards to them, these prison gang task force meetings would take place all up and down the state, and they were attended. I mean, heavily attended by law enforcement from everywhere, even from the adjacent states that were working prison gangs. And I had printed out these flyers with Ronnie and Hector's picture, you know, and I put on their wanted for the homicide, or triple homicide in San Diego this date or whatever. But I made sure that the flyers indicated who they were, what they were wanted for, when it happened, and that sort of thing. Well, not too long after that, I didn't realize, SSU worked with everybody up and down the state, but I think they work predominantly with the units that more heavily involve themselves with prison gangs, like the LAPD intelligence unit, prison gang. They were like our equivalent for San Diego. And one day, after passing all these things out, I get a call from a great investigator, Charlie Sosa from LAPD intelligence. And he says, "Hey, Charlie," he'd either call me Charlie or Mijo. And he says, "Charlie, you want Ronnie and Hector?" Like, very nonchalant. And I go, "Yeah, I want Ronnie and Hector." He said, "Well, come get them, Mijo." You know, so I thought he was BSing me. So we wound up going over there, two or three cars worth, load of guys. And we went to Parker Center, picked them up there from Charlie and his crew. And then we brought them back. And, you know, we were so excited. No one ever really thought about taking care of personal business, like going to the restroom before we came. Remember, we came from LA, did our thing, went back, and right there at on the west side of Camp Pendleton, there's a restaurant.
Hey, Carlos, before we talk about that, real quick for the listeners that don't know, the individual that actually arrested him over there in LA, then called Charlie Sosa and them, was SSU agent Brian Perry. Yep. He was actually, believe it or not, watching Topo Peters, which at the time was one of the main shot callers for the MA. They don't have a godfather, but one of the main shot callers.
Right.
Ronnie and Hector, after they murdered, you know, the three individuals or the three victims, they went to Topo Peters' mother's house in Los Angeles, in East LA, and were hiding there. And Brian Perry came on our show a couple of weeks ago, was talking about that he was watching them. And as he's watching him, all of a sudden he sees Ronnie come out and he has his no shirt on and he's trying to get some sun. Then Hector comes out. He calls the troops and that's when they arrested him at Topo Peters' mom. And Topo Peters was serving like a triple life sentence at St. Quentin, but yet his mom had these killers at the house. With that said, Benny, I know you have a question for Carlos. Hey, go ahead.
Hey, hold on, Carlos. Benny. Hey, so my buddy from Texas just sent me a text. He says, "I know Charlie and Brian worked with them. Brian became the head of parole."
Yes, he did. So head of SSU.
SSU, yeah, SSU. So, yeah. Hey, so, you know, small world. One of my mentors, you know, got to work with this guy because Hector Rios worked with the Santa Ana DA's office, but with the gang unit. He was assigned to the gang unit. Small world, man.
Brian did an awesome job of running his unit because they would hook up with all of the major units. So when SSU would hit a house or any gang member, they weren't hit by just SSU because remember they weren't that many SSU guys out there, you know. But when they hit the house, I mean, we'd hit 20 guys, you know, 25, 30 guys, cops would hit the house, SWAT everybody. But when they were taken into custody, they were thinking, "Man, SSU is out here, and you know, in numbers." They thought that everybody working there was SSU. Of course, we never told them any different.
And, exactly.
So they always thought that there was thousands of SSU guys out there.
Yeah. Those guys didn't need to be that big because the two, three guys that helped me out, man, those vatos were chingon, man.
They were chingones. Hey, yep. Benny has a question, but before he does, Calabasa 619, welcome to the show, brother. Please hit the subscribe button. He says that darn Dodger Cup threw me off. Sorry, pero San Diego Padres. Ha-ha, just saying. Órale, Benny, it's all yours. Your question. B- Benny,
your mic is off, Benny.
Your mic is off.
It's the little button that has the on-off switch.
Go ahead, Benny.
Can you hear me now?
There you go.
Yeah, go ahead.
So, you know, I'm not sure what they're going to do with Dodger Stadium since they're going to fill it with illegal aliens there pretty soon. There won't be a place to work out in L.A.
Benny, it's already full with illegal aliens.
Yeah, but they're all going to Dodger Stadium.
It's okay, brother. It's okay. We got to hug all of them.
They're going to start paying rent for the Padres for their borrow their stadium.
Hey, I know, yeah. Dude. Hey, we might get some bad players.
You know, back in the day, my experience, SSU worked a lot with the PEL teams. There was PEL teams everywhere. They had fugitive units, you know, so they were pretty active with a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And they weren't shy to ask for help and share information. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just, you know, they were great, great guys to work with. Anyway, Carlos, you know, I want you to share your conversation, if you had any, with Ronnie on the ride back to San Diego, to the county jail. You know, I've done a lot of transports, you know, and you know, I don't think I've ever had one where the suspect doesn't want to talk or starts, you know, asking for restroom breaks. I'm hungry. You know, you have to coordinate with the follow vehicles or your backup cars. What was your experience with the Ayala brothers on the transport?
You know what? No, they did very little talking at all. You know, if any talking that was done was minimal, it was by Hector. He was in the county jails. Ronnie he didn't want to talk. There was just three guys that I could never get any information out of. One was Ronnie, one was Hector, and the other guy was Tawa. That guy was the toughest to get in. He wouldn't talk about anything, not his family, nobody, you know, not the gangs. But there was very little communication, even on the way back. You know, all of us had to go to the restroom, and there were no restrooms. So we had to wait till the whole park was clear. Then we all got out. The guys did their business. Hector got out because we asked Ronnie, you need to go take a leak. And he goes, nope. And then when he saw us doing it, I guess the urge got even stronger. He goes, okay, I'll go. So we had to handcuff one hand to his belt, one free, because he says, who's going to help me take a piss? You know, and of course, not me. So not me. We wound up working it out for him. Let me rephrase that. We didn't wind up working it out for him. We assisted him in taking care of his own business.
Yeah.
You guys didn't read into that.
Yeah, we did. Go ahead, Ben, your next question.
Carlos, can you the court proceedings, can you tell us about it? You know, how were the court proceedings? Can you describe the courtroom security and the atmosphere, you know, all the stuff going back and forth, the investigators, the defense attorneys? Can you tell us about that, the DA?
Yeah, we made sure that, well, the sheriffs did it because that's what they do. You know, they made sure that they were not armed, that they were very well secured. They brought him into the courtroom. Each one of the guys had two attorneys assigned to them because it was a death penalty case. It was a homicide. And the best rated attorneys in the county, they were assigned to them. So they were represented really well. And every time they went in there, if there was a witness, they would just mad dog the witness. And they made everybody feel uncomfortable in terms of the witnesses, except one guy, and that was Rhino. Rhino wasn't afraid of them. He wasn't afraid of anybody, you know. And Rhino, just a little thing on the side here, Rhino had a real deep voice. It was a kind of a sexy voice, you know, and when he talked, he was very, very sure, very dramatic, very straightforward, you know, and he was very well built, too. He was a handsome guy. So I come to find out later, like during the lunch hour, that all the women, the court stenographers, everybody was like, oh, my God, he's so handsome, you know. And
hey, Carlos, did he look a little bit like Chalo? Just a little
exactly
bit.
Like Chalo. He did.
But with Sean's voice.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you guys have been paying attention.
Con mis ojos.
They would bring.
Y con el pelo del David.
Witnesses in. And they were all intimidated, but, you know, they would look at him because you had to identify them, you know, at the defendant's table. That's Ronnie and that's Hector and so on. but they would still testify. And my sources came up. In fact, they were all my sources. They would come in, and I even got one of the top sources, Rhino. He called me up one time because he was in county jail. I don't remember why he was there. But he would call me up every time he'd get arrested. And this time he called me and said, hey, you know, I need you to come down and talk to me, blah, blah. I want to talk to you about, you know, something really important. But he wouldn't talk on the phone. So I went up there, and it tells me that Ronnie and Hector had gone over to his house. And they had planned the robbery murder. For a certain date, they even sat down at his table and they drew a diagram and so on of the place. And on the day of the murder, and I remember, Ronnie has already put a hit on him. And he told him, it's okay, you didn't carry out the hit. You're still in the car, you're in our good graces. You know, but he knew better, because that's not how they worked. So they, on the day that they were supposed to do the robbery, they come over to pick him up. They were supposed to pick him up at a certain time. He made sure he was not there, because there was no doubt in his mind they were going to take that opportunity to kill him too. And they came back, and the wife hated them. The wife hated anything to do with gangs, you know, Mexican mafia, criminals. She was not that kind of very religious lady. And she basically chased them off. He's not here. You have to come back later when he's here. So they came back later. He still wasn't there. So they got a little desperate waiting for him. That's when they went over to Cucuy's house. I think his name was David Moreno, over in Golden Hills. I think he lived in Golden Hills. And that's when they got into his audacious van and drove down there, parked on the back or on the side. And then they went in and did their business. I'm sorry, I lost my train. Your question was, Benny, I lost my train of thought.
You know, I want you to talk about the court proceedings.
Oh, yes, yes.
Describe the atmosphere.
Oh, they were all afraid of him, you know, but they all talked. But Rhino went in there, and I got him. He'd said everything that he told me, you know, and then they had one witness that testified on their behalf. He was their alibi. But I think it was David that called me from Donovan and told me about this guy, Little Yonke from Logan. And he, Little Yonke had a wife, was married, but he was a really weak person. And his wife had been kind of sneaking him in a taste every now and then. Well, when they found out about it, they went over to him and said, you got to pay taxes and you got to have her bring in more. And so we're going to kill you. So when she came by the next time, she said, I'm not going to do that. You know, you're lucky I got, you basically said, you're lucky that I got you what I did, you know, but I'm not going to bring that in. And then they told, when he went back and told them that she was not going to do it, that she is going to do it, because we will kill you and then we'll take control of her and she will bring in the stuff for us. Well, they went to him and they told him, hey, listen, we need you to do us a favor. Once you do this, you're going to be back in the car. We'll take good care of you. You'll be in our good graces again. Heard that before? So anyhow, sure enough, they just wanted him to be an alibi. So he got transferred over to South Bay Jail in Chula Vista. And from there, they prepped him and took him to court in downtown San Diego. Well, when he went in, he testified. After he was done, I went to Gloria. I remember they were looking kind of smug. Even the attorneys, you know, we have an alibi, you know. Well, I went to Gloria Michaels, who is one of the best DAs I've ever worked with. And Gloria Michaels, I told her, Gloria, you know, since he's already testified, am I okay to talk to him now? Because remember, he was a defense witness. So they didn't want me talking to him. So Gloria didn't want me talking to him. So after he was done, I went to her, can I talk to him now? So he went, after court, they took him to the Chula Vista jail. I went over there, pulled him down, and I said, look, I don't want you to say anything. I just want you to sit here and listen to me. And I told him everything that David told me, and I told him everything that we knew. And I said it with conviction, you know, this is what they're going to do. And he knew what they were going to do. Well, while I'm telling him all this, he starts to say, no, let me finish. So while I'm talking, he starts to cry. And I'm going, ya chingo este vato. You know, he's mine now. As soon as he started crying, I go, I got him. So anyhow, he the first ask, well, my response to him was, yeah, I can help you. And he goes, well, how can you help me? And I go, I can protect you. He goes, what about my family? I can protect your family too. So I said, oh, just give me a second. I'm going to go make a phone call. I'll be right back. Okay. So I go over to the control center and I make a call to Gloria Michaels. Gloria Michaels and Mike Roland, they come over to the jail, and he repeats everything he said to me about, yeah, they were going to do this and they were going to do that. They're going to do this to my wife, my kids, you know. And he says, Gloria, can you help me? And Gloria says, yeah, we can help you. You just come testify. And all we want you to say is the truth. We don't want you to exaggerate. We don't want you to say what you think we want you to say. You just tell the truth. So the next morning, he's pulled back into jail, you know, and as a witness for the prosecution. Oh, my God. Sheila and all the other attorneys, they went crazy, you know. We have no prior notice. And of course, Gloria, well, we just found out last night ourselves. You know, we get a call from, you know, Detective Chacon. And, oh, Chacon again. You know, and then they start in on me. He winds up testifying. We wound up sending him back to South Bay. I don't even think he even went back to Donovan. I think he stayed at South Bay.
He did.
And then we wound up protecting his family, moving them from where they were to another place. You know, we put all kinds of alarms out for the house in communications. If you get any calls to this house, you send a supervisor and a minimum of 3 officers, and then call me. And then I would respond and from wherever I was. And that happened about 3, maybe 4 times. And then we wound up moving to different places. And then, of course, we wound up taking care of them. And then the other guy that we needed to take care of was the surviving victim that was the employee that got away inside the tire shop, you know. And the DA's office was doing all the protection, and we would help them, you know, with the staffing for security. And of course, people are still calling me from all over, you know, the system, you know, where Ronnie and Hector, hey, there's a guy coming out. This is his name. This is who he is. You know, he's he's got the hit. He's supposed to go out. And they would find out where he was, where he was staying. And we were thinking, where in the hell are they finding this information? Well, for all you guys that have good friends that are good friends, I'll just leave it at that, that are cops, you know, I thought, you know, I would go to fill up my gas car, my gas tank at the police gas stations. You know, and every once in a while, I'd run into a guy there, and he'd always want me, hey, how's that Ayala thing going, you know? And little did I know, he had his own investigations business, and he was doing work for the Ayala attorneys.
And PI, He was doing work for the PI, SPI?
Yeah, he had his own PI business. Wow. So they were hiring. Of course, they're not stupid. They're going to hire a cop to do cops, you know? That's where they were getting the information. Thank God he didn't stay on the department much longer. I think he left on his own. I don't know if anybody suggested that he leave, but he left on his own. We wound up intercepting 2 or 3 guys coming out of the joints, San Quentin, Folsom, you know, and we would piggyback, you know, teams, intelligence teams, would follow them out of the prison over to the buses, you know, and then they'd take them as far as their jurisdiction was. And then another team would be following all the way piggyback into San Diego. And then we picked them up from there. And then we would watch them the whole time. And they were all losers. Every last one of them. You know, inside the heck yeah, man. To use other terms. Heck yeah, I'll take him out. Just give me this. Just give me the shit. Give me some money. Send me out there, and I'll take care of it for you. They never even came close. But
we came out using heroin again, right, Carlos?
Oh yeah, we would sit in a church in a big tower, watching this guy's house where he was at. You know, and all he did was pick the crabs out of his crotch and put them up, you know, throw them on the yard. You know, and everybody's going, "Oh, what a pig!" You know, we're all talking on the air like that. You know, they were just losers. They were all losers. You know, yeah. And guys, those of you that work in prison gangs or any other kinds of gangs, just remember, be patient. get informants, and never, ever talk to anybody about any secret investigations you may have going or high-power investigations, you know, just within the people that are working those investigations. Just like those that work intelligence, we only talk about intelligence stuff amongst the people that were working the intelligence unit. You know, never talk about your families, never talk about your personal life. I don't care if they love you and they tell you they would die for you. Trust me, they don't love you and they'll never die for you. So never tell them anything.
But hey, you know, Carlos, and one of the things is follow your gut instinct, man. Your gut will tell you, even if you're working with a group and you're assigned to a group, man, if something tells you that one person, you know, is something about him, you know, just not, you know, you can feel it, man. You know, I don't know how many times when I was going through our stuff over there, is I could feel when these guys were asking a little bit too much, or, you know, they would ask something and you're going like, nah, this guy's fishing. He's on a fishing expedition. You know, he wants to get that one up on us, you know, and you'll get killed because of their, you know, they don't care. I mean, they're compromised.
Yeah, just claim stupidity. You know what? I'm not the guy to talk to about that stuff. Yeah. If you want to talk about that, you know, want to know about it, talk to that guy and have him tell him no. But David and I would always tell, you know, everybody that we talk to, don't talk about your personal life. Don't put the stickers on the bumpers of your car because you're proud of your kid because he graduated with honors from the second grade, you know, at Palomar Elementary, you know, or your daughter graduated with honors from high school, and she's, you know, or I am a UCSD dad or whatever. Don't put any of that stuff. You know, go get a nice chrome license plate bracket, you know, and it has a nice saying, and then leave it at that. But never trust anybody. I don't know if David has it.
Definitely. Go ahead, Charlo. You have a question?
Yeah. So real quick, like, you know, getting pretty close to the end of the show. So please share with us the day that they found them guilty, you know, that they were both in the day they were both sentenced to death. You know, what happened? How'd you feel that day? How was the emotions that day?
Well, you know, I think that the team, everyone that was involved in this whole investigation thing from the prosecution side, I think we all went out and celebrated out of relief. You know, these guys were animals. They're not to be trusted. I mean, if people inside the joints doing time on the mainland will come forward and testify against them in their the penalty phase of their trial, I mean, it tells you what kind of people they are. You know, just don't trust anybody. We felt great. We felt awesome. And I knew that if for some reason or other, on some technicality, they'd come out, there would be hell to pay.
How long did the trial last, Carlos?
Oh, months.
Months.
Okay. Half a year, probably.
Wow. Hey, just going back to, I mean, we've talked about this case, you know, and everything, you know, prepping up to this. And I'm pretty sure, I mean, there's things that we always think about. But is there anything that you think you could have done differently or for this case? I mean, if there's anything, I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, we always, you know, especially us guys that are really like to work our cases really good and everything. We've always trying to, you know, Monday morning quarterback, or, you know, could we have done anything different, better, or not spent so much time doing something here? Should have done. Is there anything you in this case could have done differently?
No, you know, there's nothing that you can do too much of. No matter what you do, whether it's talking to sources, creating informants, reading up on their history, talking to their friends, talking to their family, you can never get enough information. And, you know, gracias a Dios, David and I both grew up in the same neighborhoods that they did. And if they trust you, never betray them. You know, just make sure that you either cut them loose or protect them. But always do that. But would I have done anything different? No. Gracias a Dios, I was just blessed to have grown up in that environment that I did.
You know, and you hit the nail on the head, man. I was born and raised in Calexico, started as an explorer, went all the way, you know, and worked every, and you know what, being from town and being a fair person, and then they knowing that you're a fair guy, not that you don't give favors, that you do little favors, but they're not really favors. You just treat them well, with respect. Man, that made me solve a lot of cases. I got a lot of info where dope was coming, where guns were going, where money was coming, who did what. And this is a prime example with you. I mean, you had all your sources that would call you. They're all people that you and, you know, David, the same thing with David, people you guys grew up with, you know, yeah. That they feel comfortable talking to you and they know you're a cop because they also want to see justice sometimes, you know, yeah. not everybody. Everybody wants justice. So, man, hats off to you, Carlos.
Thank you.
Benny, go ahead.
Hey, Carlos, I'm sure you want to thank all the investigators that helped you out, all the units. Who were some of the most important people, or not most important, but the where did you get the most help in this case? Who helped you the most?
You know, this was successful because of starting from the top, from the prosecutor's office, you know, Gloria Michaels, Mike Rowland, Marquez, Robert Marquez, SSU. My hat's off to everybody in SSU, Los Angeles PD Intelligence from gang unit at the time, the Sheriff's Intelligence Unit. I mean, we all came together. When it was time to come together, everybody came together, and we did one bang-up job. You know, so my hat's off to all of them.
Hey, Carlos, I heard in...
One more thing? Yes. The classification deputies in the jails. Those guys made it happen.
You know, Carlos, I heard, and I think either you mentioned it to me a while back, you got an attaboy, didn't you, from Chief Bergering that was, you know, very nice, very, very well written and giving you a lot of kudos for the investigation and your involvement in this case.
Yeah. Yeah. They gave me a real nice COC commendation, letter of commendation, because almost all of the witnesses for the prosecution, not all of them were either cultivated or brought forth by me. But it was a nice letter. It was a very nice letter thanking me for that. Thanking Colander, I mean, Bergering at the time, you know, for my work. It's nice to be recognized.
Yes, most it definitely. Is.
And you know what, Carlos? You're recognized by them. They know that it was you that was a case agent on this case. You're recognized by all law enforcement that know this case. And once again, brother, thank you very much for the outstanding work that you did, for the outstanding service you did for the city of San Diego and everybody in the Mexican Mafia. While you were in intelligence in San Diego and also in LA, they knew who Carlos Chacon was. So, hey, brother, you know what? That legacy, you're leaving it for your kids, you're leaving it for your family, and within San Diego PD, you have that legacy. You know what? It's right now is the time that we say goodbye to you, but I don't want to say that yet because I want to talk real briefly. I know we're over an hour. We usually like to stay under an hour. But the question that I have is this for all of us, where are they now? Okay, back in 1987, I believe, is when they were sentenced to death. We did an episode on Sheepdog, how they were transported to St. Quentin. Well, they've been in St. Quentin since 1987. And they were supposed to be put to death. Now with our new Governor Newsom, the death penalty no longer exists. So now what are they doing now? Well, what we know about them, Carlos, and I want your feedback on this, and everybody, Sean, I want your feedback. Now, they've been there since 1987. They were supposed to die. They're not going to die there. Now they're going to do their life sentence without parole in different state prisons. They're going to be re-released to general pop. But now, within the prison system, Carlos, these individuals, these criminals, are still involved in criminal activities. Ronnie owes a couple of lives. He's killed a couple of people in there. They haven't been able to prosecute him. And if they do prosecute him, how can they give him an additional life sentence when he's already doing life without parole?
Exactly.
Three years ago, San Diego PD with the Violent Crimes Task Force, they did a case on Ronnie. I believe it was called Operation Death Row Murder Incorporated, where he was literally from inside of his cell, Chalo and Benny, Sean, inside of his cell, ordering hits all over California with a cell phone that was snuck into him. He was calling his family once or twice a week, having one-hour conversations with him while incarcerated in death row. So these guys, yeah, we could get them and send them to Pelican Bay. We could send them to Tehachapi. We could send them to Modesto. We could send them to any state prison that you could think of, Salinas Valley, high level. But they still have access to these cell phones and still involve in criminal activity. I personally believe, guys, and I know this isn't a Davis show, but I need to let this out, that it's RICO time. It's time to get these guys under a federal act, the RICO Act, and after they're hit with the RICO Act, send them where Weddle Sherm, send them where Bat Marquez, send them where Chapo Guzman and everybody else is in the ADX Flores Supermax prison. What's your thoughts, guys?
Well, from my perspective, I'm actually surprised with all the up-and-coming new youngsters that they don't try and take these guys out because they're older and we need a new regime. You know, that's the way it's always been. It's always been like that. But these guys do need to go to a supermax. They need to be able, with Bat Marquez and everybody else, you know, because these guys are just going to get worse and worse and worse. And they're going to continue to send out hits all over on the streets in there. And for you correctional deputies or officers, you are the first line of defense for your children, for the communities, for law enforcement out on the street. You guys are the first line of defense. When you let them out, then the guys on the streets will take it from there. But the cell phones, the dope, I mean, you guys are the ones that need to step in and lean into that discomfort, because it is a scary discomfort area.
Well, you know, Carlos, when we were there, you know, by the way, Ronnie's photo right here is compliments him, because I'm telling you, he looks a lot older than that, and he still looks very menacing. But while we were there, you know, one of the, you know, Petros, the lieutenant, was talking to another higher up there in the Department of Corrections, and he mentioned that we were from San Diego. At that time, there was a double escort, two COs escorting an individual. And he just turned around and mad-dogging us. And the word is, he started eye-fucking us all the way through the tier, all the way to the top tier. And he just kept staring at us. And we were told that that's Ronnie's boy. He's one of Ronnie's prototypes. You know, he's probably going to be the next guy in the mm-hmm. Army. But and they said they still carry a lot of juice there. I mean, they are the main guys there, and their IQ is extremely high. He said they got some of the highest IQ in prison.
Well, yeah. I mean, all they do is read books, law books, and everything else. So I mean, that's one of the things that I've always said. You know, and every time somebody got paroled out, these bastards came out stronger, faster. I always just say, you know what? Start feeding them ho-hos and Coca-Colas. You know, give them TVs, tickle. You know, they took away the weights. I said, get them fat. You know, but then again, you know, the ACW or what's ACLU? There you go. They would have done something because of their food. But I mean, these guys come out, you know, bench pressing, you know, tow trucks and shit like that because they eat well, they exercise well. I said, that's the only way we're going to stop these guys is, like you said, you know, take away a lot of the stuff. But everybody's afraid. I mean, Governor Newsom, somebody that just put in the comments, I got people that I know they're in corrections, and they get pissed because they give them tablets now. They're always on their tablets.
Moreno just said that, yes.
Yeah, and then they also give them some sort of drug to calm them down. So they get these guys all hooked up on like a barbiturate, and some of these guys don't even take it. They'll put them in their mouth and they walk out and they have a little canister and they start selling this dope, you know, to the ones that are real tecatos in there that, you know, like to use that stuff. I mean everything that the Governor Newsom, we can go on for hours on this, is doing is hurting the state, because it's like criminals get everything. And the ACLU and them, they're a money-making business. They don't give a rat's ass about the people. I mean, they live in gated communities. You know, they live the posh life, you know, because especially the CEOs and them, I mean, they're making, you know, six figures, you know, $500,000 like that. Whatever they're making, they don't care. I mean, they don't care about the people that, you know, the working-class people that have to put up with this crap going in and out of their neighborhoods or in their neighborhoods.
Yeah. Well, guys, like I said before, we're past our time, but I hope that there's an AUSA that's watching the show, or a prison gang investigators watching the show, that you talk to your AUSA and you do a federal RICO Act case on these individuals, Ronnie and Hector, and it's time to take them out of the state of California. It's time to send them to Colorado, to ADX Florence State Prison, and lock them up for life, and let that be their burial grounds. With that said, Carlos, once again, thank you very much. We're going to go around. We're going to give our sayings. Carlos, so if you could tell us a saying or something that has been inspirational for you, for somebody that's watching the show. Dale recio, Carlos.
You be the leader. You be the front line and let everybody follow you. Don't let anybody back you down. Don't talk about your personal life.
Amen. Chalo.
Like with me, it's real simple. The one word, integrity. Integrity means everything in this job and in your life. You know, never lose it. Because once you lose it, that's it.
Big Sean.
Live tactically and be safe in everything that you do.
Benny.
Carlos, first of all, I want to thank you for mentoring all the deputy sheriffs that worked the jail all those years that you came back and forth, they interviewed the crooks, and, you know, for everything you did. I mean, you were well known by everyone in our department when it came to prison gangs. So thank you for that. You know, and my shout out's always the same, you know, for those that are working that blue line, you know, and to the old CEOs, and, you know, prepare for the fight of your life. Fight dirty. I mean, get tough, get mean. Train, know the job, don't hesitate. Stay in the fight and survive. And remember, experience comes from our mistakes.
And Carlos, once again, man, your legacy, Carlos Chacon, will live forever. Not only in Otay, but it will live forever with San Diego PD and every prison gang investigator that is currently or that has investigated any mafia case. Your name and your legacy will live forever. With that said, live a purpose-driven life. Live every day like it's your last day on earth. You're never too old to volunteer. You're never too young to volunteer. With that said, thank you and God bless you.